hopefully this picks everything up. All right, how to choose an open source license is the workshop today. As Mark explained earlier, you know, one of the criteria for this hackathon is everything has to be open source that we release. Yay, open source. I'm a big proponent of it for my day job. So that's what this is going to be about, how to make the decision about what open source license you want to use. So a little bit about myself first, with the mouse out of the way, it's not annoying. Hi, I'm Mike Miles. I work in Boston. I've been a developer for 15, 16 years now, professionally. I work for a company called Genuine. We're a full-service digital agency. I'm not going to give you the whole spiel because you guys didn't pay for that. That's what I do when I get sent to conferences. I talk about Genuine. But we do a lot of cool projects. We were just named the agency of record for Welch's, and they just relaunched Welch's and this great campaign, which is really cool. And I'm a technical architect, which means I help design and architect from a technical perspective all the projects we work on, the tech projects. My focus is using open source technologies for that, so mainly the Drupal framework, if you've heard of that. And as Mark said, I also have a podcast called Developing Up, which is focused on the non-technical side of being a developer, so things like working on a team and how to say no to clients, how to stick up for yourself, topics like that. So check it out if you're so inclined. And then finally, if you want to know any more about me after this talk, everywhere online, I'm just MikeMiles86. Guess what year I was born? It's not 1886. So that's usually my handle. If you see that, that's me, unless it's something you don't agree with, and that is some other Mike Miles. So what we're going to cover today, I don't think it would be very beneficial just to say, here's how to choose an open source license, because that's like giving a man a fish. You want to teach a man to fish, right? So I broke this up into three sections. The first and foremost is why to choose an open source license for your project. What's the importance of doing that? I thought having that background knowledge just puts things in perspective about the value that open source technology provides to the world. Following up that is what open source licenses actually are, the protections they provide and what they seek to accomplish and why you might want to use them. And then finally, yes, how to choose the right open source license, the right one for your project, either today or going forward. Sound good? Sound like a good plan? All right. First and foremost, I am not a lawyer. Very important thing to tell you. Intellectual property law is very complex, very difficult, and anything that I tell you today is not legal advice. Again, I am not a lawyer. But this should be a big red flag. Hopefully this will be helpful info, but if you start building something open source and you want to pursue it for intellectual purposes or make money from it or whatever you want to do with it, be sure to check with a lawyer. Just don't go off, hey, this is what Mike Miles told me to do for a license. Please don't do that. All right, with that warning, the code you write, the software you write, it's art. And that's not just my opinion as a developer, being someone biased who loves to show off the cool code he writes, but it's an actual fact that the software that you write is a piece of creative work. It's the same as writing a book or producing music. It's treated the same way in terms of property. So what that means is the code that you write is just really creative. So if you're a developer, you're a creative person, don't let anyone tell you any different. But what that also means is intrinsically, when you write a line of code or you produce a piece of software, you have a copyright claim on that. Whether you invoke that copyright claim or not, it's there by default. Whenever you write code and software and you put it out there, you have copyright. So what does that mean? And I thought it was important to explain what copyright means, just so we all understand. So copyright is basically this. You write some software, you have copyright claim on it. I'm going to symbolize that with this little lock icon. What's the word I want? It is proprietary to you, to yourself. That means that as the copyright owner, you have the right to distribute copies of your code or your software to people. So you can sell your software, right? If you're a video game developer, you can sell your video games to other people, retailers who resell it for you. But those people that you give copies of your software to, they can't take your software are not allowed to distribute to somebody else. They don't have the claim to make copies. This is what happens with music and books as well. As the copyright owner, only you have the rights to say, I'm going to distribute this to other people. No one else is allowed to do that. If they do, I mean, with software, it's hard to kind of stop them, except for legal purposes. You have the right to go after them for legal rights and to collect money. So they cannot do that. Copyright is the legal right of a creator to control distribution and alterations of their software. So any software you write, you have that right intrinsically to control who can get your software. Now, software you write as well, just out of the box when you create it, since it's copyrighted by default, it means only you can define its use. So all the software we're writing today, all the projects we're working on today, you know, it's to solve a single problem or a specific type of problem, a nautical theme problem. Since if you don't make your code, your software open source, you may not realize that your software could be used to solve a problem, say for automated driving, or for space exploration, for navigating satellites around debris, let's say. Your software could have very great applications in that area, but unless you are the one who think of it to use it that way, you're gonna miss those opportunities. Because only you define the use. You are saying, this software can only be used to solve this problem. As well as software you write, right when you create it, it's copyrighted, only you can create improvements for it. So this means, you know, you wrote the software to help ships navigate, you figure out a way to make it work 10 times faster, you add that alteration on, you distribute it, no problem. But because it's copyrighted, it's patented, not patented, it's, keep forgetting that word, whatever. You own it, no one else can really see the code base. If someone else thinks, hey, there's a better algorithm to make this work better, they can't easily give you that update. They don't have the view into your code base, nor do they have the availability easily to let you use it, because their addition, their alteration is copyrighted by them, right? It's their creative work. So there's all these legalities about incorporating copyrighted work into other copyrighted work. So that you can't really do out of the box. The big question comes up, why do we write software? What is the purpose of it? Now, this is a big existential question that we all have as developers. Think about, why do we do this? And I believe there is one reason why everyone writes software. That's because we want to solve problems for the world. I guarantee you there's not one person who's a developer in this room who decided they want to write software because they want to make someone's life harder. You want to write software to solve problems for other people. Sometimes global problems. You know, you want to make the world a better place with the software you write, especially for the software you're writing today. So if you want your software to change the world, what better way than to let the world help you change your software? And that's what it means to be open source. It means to open your software to the world, both to give it out freely and to collect improvements back. You know, get the dev collective to help you make your software better or work with other people. Now, open source does not always mean free. By this, what I mean is there are people who worry about using open source software, and I can tell you this for sure from someone who's client-facing, that they're worried that because they're using open source technology, they can't make money on what they want to build. That's not true. That's not what open source is about. There is part of that about free software and the Free Software Foundation, who wants to make all software free. Nothing wrong with that. But just because you make your software open source doesn't mean you are losing the ability to make money from it if you so choose. So I just like to put that caveat out there. But what do you get if you make your software open source? So we have the software we're writing today. We have our copyright claims on it by default. If we were to make it open source, get rid of that copyright claim, you allow for derivative works. So what does derivative mean? Derivative means someone can look at your source code because you've opened it up to the world, and they can go ahead and make a change to it so it solves a different problem. Problem maybe you didn't even think your code would work for, but they saw that as your base. Someone else can then take that code as well and make a different change and make it work for another application. They can start using your software to really fix the problems in the world using your creative idea as a base, which is amazing. Derivatives is an alteration. or an extension of a piece of software, really of creative work, but for our purposes, software. So it's the ability to allow someone to make a change and distribute that change. The same thing with making your software open source and removing that claim, that copyright claim and that protection to some degree, you invite improvements from other people. So back to that case where maybe you have a bug in your software and you don't know it exists, someone else finds it and they can contribute that back to it and they can fix your code for you. You get that benefit. Or someone else can make an addition to make your code work with a different application. Someone else can add maybe a new layer, a new GUI application to make it easier to use. You know, you invite the world in to make improvements. Now there's arguments about this model, about having open source software and letting other people contribute to it, or having your source code available. That is a security issue. For example, Equifax, right, that's how you say them, the big security breach that happened, they're blaming it on the open source software they're using, which is an Apache Arch product. The problem, though, was that there was a known vulnerability in that software that the community found and provided a patch for. They provided an alteration and a fix for. Equifax decided not to apply that patch to their software, and they left themselves vulnerable. Don't blame the open source software. You know, blame the people who aren't maintaining their product that uses it. Just want to put that up there. So, okay. You know, the value of open sourcing your software is that you invite the world to make improvements or to use it for their purposes. Why use a license? Why not just say, here, world, here's my code, do with what you want. You know, put it in the public domain or what's known as an unlicense. You could do that, but an open source software license gives you some protection than just releasing out to the wild, and this is what it allows you to do. So if you have your software and you say, here's an open source license, I'm going to apply to it. I'm going to add my open source license, my software, to a package that I'm not going to open source, that I'm going to keep proprietary, that I'm going to use to sell a product to then, you know, for ship navigation. This piece can be open source and other people can see it. This piece is not open source. It solves a certain problem, and that's your layer where you're going to, you know, make money if you want to do that. Someone can come along and they can see your software and make an alteration, again, and solve a different problem. No issue. But another company could come along and they'd be like, you know what? There we go. I'm going to take your software, I'm going to put it in my own package, and I'm going to solve a boat navigation problem. Now, if you don't have an open source license, there's nothing you can do to stop someone from doing that. But an open source license gives you the ability to set patent claims. And this can go both ways. That you can say, you can use my software for whatever you want, except you can't compete and do the same thing I'm doing with my proprietary stuff. That's perfectly fine. That's one of the reasons to use an open source license, among many. So without the open source license, just putting it out there in public domain, you can't stop anyone from infringing on what you want to use the software for, or solving the same problems as you. So this just came up actually with WordPress. So have people heard of WordPress? Yeah. Have people heard of Facebook? Yeah. Have people heard of React? So React is a JavaScript library, I think, built by Facebook, open sourced, and WordPress put it into their code base. They're now taking it out because Facebook said, you know what, we're using the BSD open source license that has a patent clause in it, and we're really going to enforce that anything you build with React does not infringe on Facebook's patents. And Facebook has a lot of patents because they want to do everything. And how can you really argue that, you know, your little community to find locations to clean beaches does not infringe on Facebook's application? You can't. So people are going to remove it. But that's what a license does. It helps protect your patent claims if you need to and other things. I kind of went off on a tangent there for a second, sorry. So what is an open source license? It is a license that allows software to be freely used, modified, and shared while putting in guidelines about how that can be used. It allows you to set up some rule sets that people have to follow to use your software. Now, who defines open source licenses? Where do they come from? The best location is the Open Source Initiative. This is an organization who's been around since the 60s, and they're, I believe they're nonprofit. Yeah, they're most definitely a nonprofit. Their job every day is they review people's licenses and they say, yes, this meets the criteria for open source, no, it does not. It means you as a developer can look at their list and know that one of the licenses they approve really protects you and it protects the people using your software. Now, there's a lot of criteria that they evaluate open source licenses with, and I want to highlight just a couple pieces of it. First and foremost, an open source license must be free to use. An open source license cannot itself have a license that says you have to pay me to use my open source license. There are people who try to do that. In the community I work with, Drupal, there's been this whole debate about some license stuff, and there's a person trying to sell a community license for the way our community should work. It's just like, it doesn't work that way, man. That's not how it works. So open source licenses cannot, they must be free to redistribute. They must be free for other people to use them. Open source licenses must require access to the source code. Now, if you're building something that compiles or not, well, if you build software that compiles, you have to provide access to the uncompiled version, the unobfuscated version, or just your software in general. Question?
Sorry to interrupt that, but when, so you were talking about like how, I was trying to make sure I understand the change. Sure. So when open source is copyright, you have your own copyright and you can control, only you can distribute your software.
Right, only you can potentially view the source of it.
Yeah, and then when does the license come into play? Do I create a license?
So I'll get into that. No problem. That's a great question. That's a great question. So open source licenses usually all have a clause, or they must have a clause for the OSI to approve it that explain how the source code has to be accessible. And then finally, they must allow for creative, alterations.
Derivatives.
See, I knew you were paying attention. So they usually have a clause that allow for derivative works. Now there's other criteria, there's about 10 pieces, such as not limiting what software the license could be used on or who's allowed to use the license, like not targeting a certain group of people or excluding a certain group of people. But these three really focus on the software that will use that license. And one other, not really listed criteria, but all well-known licenses have a clause about, is providing attributions. Knowing that if you're going to release your code with a certain license, open source license, anyone using it has to have attributions back to you. At least a file that says, hey, this software was originally developed by so-and-so. Excuse me. Now, there are two main types of open source licenses. The first are known as copyleft licenses. So these put in restrictions about how your software can be used, who's allowed to make changes to it or alterations, and how they must treat those alterations or those derivatives. And the other type are known as permissive licenses. These are almost, they're almost like putting your code in the public domain, except you can have patent clauses and some other like attribution clauses in there. So I want to talk about these two main types. Copyleft. Copyleft works like this. You have your open source software. You say, I'm going to apply a copyleft license to it. What this means is if someone makes a derivative of your work, they have to also apply an open source license to their derivative work. If someone makes an add-on or an alteration, say a patch, they have to release that add-on, that alteration, using an open source license as well. It perpetuates the use of open source licenses, which I'm a real big fan of. As well as if your software is going to be used in a package, whether it's another package of software to be redistributed, that also has to use an open source license to some degree. So copyleft is the condition that a derivative, addition, or distribution must use itself, usually the same license or at least an open source license. So copyleft licenses actually fall into two categories. One is known as weak copyleft, and that covers the conditions that derivatives and additions or add-ons use the same exact license as the original work. So if you pick the Apache 2.0 license, or the Apache 2.0 license, then any derivative must use the same license. It doesn't rule, or most of them do not include any clauses saying your software, if it's included in a package, that package has to use the same license. So weak copyleft licenses allow your software to be packaged into something that can be proprietary or copyrighted and sold. Now, there's another type of copyleft called strong copyleft, which covers all these bases. Anytime your software is used, however it's used, whatever is using it has to use the same exact license as your software. That's basically what strong copyleft says. The most well-known software or license that strong copyleft is the GPL license, the GNU GPL license. Now, permissive licenses, as I said, they're almost like public domain. What they allow for is you have your software, you apply an open source permissive license to it. Someone can create a derivative, and they can add a different license to their derivative. It has to, most of the time, it does have to fall in policy with your permissive license, but they can use a different type of license. Same with an add-on or alteration. It can use itself a different license, and then any packages that your software gets used into, it can use any sort of license, including it can be copyrighted and protected, or proprietary. So permissive licenses just make sure that derivative additions or distributions don't have to use the same license. That's what they say, but they provide you protection, again, such as patent clauses and whatnot. So knowing this, that there are three basic types of open source licenses, strong copyleft, weak copyleft, and permissive, how do you decide which type of open source license is right for you? That's the $1 million question. The $0 question, as it might be. Really, in my opinion and in my experience, it comes down to asking yourself four questions. That's all you need to know what type of open source license to go with. The first two questions I don't think many people think of. The last two may be a little obvious to you, but using all four together is really helpful. First and foremost, what licenses are already in use in your software? If you're building everything from scratch, then you don't have to worry about this question. But if you're using an existing library, existing framework, all those have a license. Hopefully they're open source already, but you want to read what licenses they have. Maybe you're using a library that has a strong copyleft license, which means you yourself have to have a strong copyleft license. Maybe they have permissive and they're like, do with what you want, and that's helpful to you to know. Again, this is sort of the deal that came up with React, right? They have a pretty much permissive license that had a patent clause in it. But that kind of dictated to people, hey, I'm using this library that has this license. I have to kind of comply with this license. So make sure you check the code you're using. If it's written by somebody else, what license they attach to that library. If you don't agree with it, you're going to have to find something else to use or change your license. The second question, what are the terms of service of where you're hosting your software to give it out as open source? This weekend, we're all using GitHub. GitHub's terms of services actually state that you must have your code allow for forking. The code base must allow people to make derivatives. That's default how GitHub works. So if you're not comfortable with releasing software and having derivatives, you may have to keep that in mind. All right, the third question, the first two are kind of like outside influences. The next two come from inside what feels right for you. Do you want derivatives, additions, and distributions to have to use the same license as your software? Do you want to perpetuate the license that you're using, whether it's a strong copyleft like the GPL license or a permissive license like the MIT license? Do you care if, however your software is being used, that those other uses follow the same rules as you? If you do, then you're going to want to look into a copyleft license. If you don't care, you just want people to use your software, then you probably want a permissive license. And then finally, say you do want a copyleft license, you do care how derivatives are used, you have to ask yourself, can others use my software in their proprietary work? If you say, sure, you can use my software in your proprietary code base. That's fine with me. Then you'll probably want a weak copyleft license because you don't care so much if your code is included in a package. But if you do care and you say, know what, you can't use my code in your copyrighted work or your proprietary work, then you want a strong copyleft license. Again, you want to make sure everyone follows the same rules you're following. So those are the four questions to ask yourself. I know that went really quickly, but that's how simple it is to choose what type of license to use. You may say, okay, Mike, I get it. I'll ask myself those four questions. I know what type of license to use, but which license specifically do I pick? I can't tell you that. This is how to choose the right license, not the right license that's right for you. It's all going to depend on you and your team and the decisions you make. So you're going to have to do some research. I'm not going to give you the magic bullet and say use this license every time. I'm just going to give you these guidelines. So once you know the type of license you want to use, I'll give you three pieces of advice of what to do next. First and foremost, only use licenses that have been approved by the OSI, the Open Source Initiative. Again, this is what they do for a living, is they review licenses, make sure they are happy for everybody, that there are not some like twisted clause in there that's going to screw you over in the end. As well as if you wanted to write your own license, before you decide to do that, I'd submit it to the OSI and see if it follows the open source guidelines, if you want to call your project open source. But I'd recommend not writing your own license, unless you're someone like Facebook, who has the legal teams to correctly draft it. Opensource.org/licenses provides a list of OSI-approved licenses with the top six at the top. So once you know the type of license, go look at their list. And then my second guideline is to read the license. Understand what you are applying to your code base. Now, legalese is complicated. I'm not claiming, again, I did not claim to be a lawyer. I don't claim either any of you are lawyers. So I'd recommend going to tldrlegal.com. What this website does, TLDR stands for too long, didn't read. You can put in the name of a license, you can put the name of a term of service, and it pulls up a simplified English version of what that license is saying. So it's really a blurb that says, this license means this. It allows you to do this, you can't do this with it. It's a really quick way and easy way to review what a license means for your project. Again, they will claim they are not lawyers, and this is not legal advice, but it helps you understand, so you don't need a lawyer to understand the license. So get an approved license, understand what you're applying to your project, and then finally, once you pick a license and you release your code or your software, do not change the license. This is to protect you, but also to protect the people who are using your code. As soon as you release it, you have to assume a derivative has been created, which if you're using, say, a strong copyleft license, that means that person has to follow a strong copyleft. If you were to change your license, then you enter all sort of legal limbo about, well, when you copy my code, I just changed the license, so now you have to follow this clause, but this person has already distributed it. It's a crazy mess. You can create new releases with new licenses, but once you release code, do not change the license. Save yourself the headache. So choose wisely. Okay, so this went kind of quick, but to recap, your open source projects, the ones you write today, the ones you write tomorrow, the ones you write a year from now can change the world. That's the value of open source, is you can change the world, and the world can change your code. It's not just you relying on yourself. It's a great way to be collaborative. Allow your software to be freely used, modified, shared by using an open source license. Make sure you can set guidelines for how it's being used and promote the usage of open source if that's your prerogative, if you want to do that and you care about that, which I hope you do. Flare. And then finally, select the right open source license for your project by asking yourself some simple questions. What libraries am I using? What are the terms of service of where I want to host my code? Do I care about how derivatives and distributions are created? And if I do they have to follow the same license as I? Answering those questions will allow you to figure out what type of license to choose, strong copyleft, weak copyleft, or permissive. And then from there, you can go ahead, look at the list of approved OSI licenses, find the best one for you. So with that recap, I have some resources and references here. I talked about all of them. First, though, is this Bitly link, HackCOSL, in capitals. That links to this presentation, which is as open source as I can make it, because it's Google Slides. So you have the ability to make a copy of it if you want to, and change it, make a derivative, go for it. Opensource.org links to the open source initiative. ChooseALicense.com is a fun tool by GitHub, I believe, which will help you make a quick decision about what type of license you want. It's one less step than the questions I posed to you. TLDRLegal.com, which will turn legalese into English so you can understand what you're agreeing to. And then again, my podcast, I'd be ever so grateful if you took a look at it. Season 2 is going to come out starting in October, and I'm excited about it because I'm having chats with actual developers for Season 2, which is a lot of fun. So please check it out. I'd appreciate that. So we do have time for questions. I have time to help make a decision for a license for the different groups that are here, if you want to do that. But you can also reach out later. Again, hit me up on Twitter at MikeMiles86, or I'll be in the room for the rest of the day working on my own project, but I'm happy to stop and talk about licenses. Because you've been such a good crowd, here's the list of the 6 top OSI approved licenses. We have strong copy left, the GPL license and the Eclipse license. And please do not ask a question about the differences between these, because I do not know. The weak copy left, the most popular, are the LGPL, so the Lesser General Public License, I think it stands for, and the Mozilla Public License 2.0. And then permissive is MIT and Apache 2.0. I'll let you know that the project I'm working on today, I've already applied the MIT license to it, because I mean, it's just information that Rich and I are putting out there that we are gathering from other people. So I don't care. There's no patented information I'm going to put in there, right? So it's just HTML markup. So why not make it permissive? I guess we should have discussed that before I made the unilateral decision. Okay, so when I give presentations, usually at this stage, I ask for applause, but you're not required to give it. Does anyone have any questions they want to ask?
This might be a blurry question, but if you post something without a license attached, what does that mean?
So if you post something without a license attached, it means it's copyrighted by you. You have to apply some sort of license that lets other people know that you're removing your copyright claim. Now you're going to get people, if you just release code and there's no license to it, you'll have some people who will be like, oh, I'm going to use it. Whatever, I'm going to take it. He didn't say anything. But they're risking, you know, a legal battle with you if you so care to go after them. So you're going to get a lot of people who you may think that you're releasing it open source because you didn't put a license on it, but people won't touch your code because they're not sure the legalities of it. That's why it's always best to add a license, even if you want to do what's known as an unlicense. So you can go to unlicensed.org, I think it is, and that's basically a license that says, this is free to the world. I remove all copyright claim indefinitely. So it's like public domain. I'd recommend if you don't care about, not that if you don't care, if you want to make your code as free as possible, you can do that. So to answer your question, if you don't put a license out there, people are going to assume it's copyrighted by you and you have a copyright claim, or they should. Great question. Any other questions?
Can you explain a little bit about the license you applied to the project you're working on and how that works? Why you picked it? Like, what would?
So the MIT permissive license, or the MIT license, is a really, if you go to tldrlegal.com and put it at MIT license, it'll tell you, it basically allows your code to be used for anything. It does have some patent claims that are clauses in it and attribution clauses. So the reason I picked it was because what we're working on is just information we're giving out. There's nothing that we could really do to change what we're building to be a service to make money from or have patented on. But I'd still like attribution if someone were to take our code and fork it on GitHub, that then, you know, we get credit for the work we did this weekend.
Okay.
So it's the very bare, it's like the bare minimum open source license to use.
Yeah.
That's why I applied it. So I wanted open source. That's one of the rules of the hackathon. It has to be open source. We have to choose a license. And that's a permissive license.
What about terms of, what's the difference between like a license and terms?
Of service?
So
a license gets applied to a project. So for example, GitHub, it's a service that you create an account on, so your account has to agree to their terms of service. You have to say, as a user, I'm going to follow your rules for your environment. Actually, actually, so they're actually pretty similar. For your project though, on GitHub, it has a license applied to it that says anybody using this code base has to use this license or follow these guidelines. So they're kind of the same if you think about it abstractly, that users of your software have to follow the guidelines you apply, and users of the service have to follow the terms of service.
Oh, okay. So that'd be like if we wanted to put a prompt on the website that said, hey, you gotta agree before you use our website.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Anytime you sign up for something, you have to agree to terms of service. You agree to the rules that they set out, where if you don't follow them, they can kick you out, or they can cancel your account, or whatnot. That's a good question. Anything else? No? Awesome. Thank you again. I appreciate you taking the time to stop hacking to listen to me.
Thanks, Mike. That was helpful.
Let me see if I can stop this. Oh, another thing.